had it happened last Saturday about 1 o'clock, and my wife Deb was going to my little nephew's wedding shower in Montgomery, Alabama. So we had some friends over, a day before to do some bow hunting, and we had fixed up 5 or 6 stands so that they could have, their choice of where they wanted to go. And I have another probably 7 or 8 stands, and we're very, very safety-minded here. And nobody gets in a stand without a safety belt. There's got to be a lifeline on a tree, which is a line that attaches to the top of the tree, ties to the bottom of the tree. And when you start up the ladder, you hook in, and then you're hooked in all the way up. When you get in the stand, all the way down. So there's no way for you to fall once you get hooked into the lifeline. So we have the stands up, and generally what we do at the end of the year, we'll go and, kind of release the tension on the straps because the trees grow. And I'll go make sure that the straps are all, the tension's all right, that the stands are all good, and put a lifeline up. And I had 2 lifelines that I was going to put up that day. Deb took off to go to, Montgomery, and I was on a 4-wheeler, drove over here, put 1 lifeline up, piece of cake. It only takes 10 minutes. And so I drove across the dam of the lake and went to the other one and crawled up, and that stand was in good shape. It was solid. Of course, I had my safety belt on. I had my lifeline on my arm, and I checked. There was 1 strap that needed to be adjusted an inch. So I adjusted it, got up to the top, looked at the stand, and the stand was solid. So I'm like, okay, I can get up and attach this lifeline. So I got up into the tree stand and reached around. I've got hooks on all my stands, and I reached around to hook into the tree, and right as soon as I grabbed my strap to reach up to hook into the tree, it was like a hangman's gallows. The stand just let go, and down I went. I hit 20 feet. I don't know if I hit on, I hit on my right side, but I don't know if I hit on my foot, my leg, or if I hit, I just don't know. But, I never lost consciousness, but I knew that, I hit hard. And I thought, okay, let me just sit here for a minute and see if I can't catch my breath and move a little bit. And I sat there for a couple of minutes and then realized that I wasn't going anywhere. I mean, I couldn't move an inch. I could tell that I was having major problems in my pelvis. But, I could wiggle my toes. I could move my arms. I could move my head, and I was still conscious. So I'm like, okay, I just, took a fall. So I had my phone in my pocket, which was key to this whole thing. I grabbed my phone out, and being in a spot on my farm where I had cell service was key. Got Deborah on the phone, told her that I had fallen, that she's going to have to come back. She's going to have to call 911 and come and help me. So she turned around. She was 15 minutes away. She turned around and met the 911 emergency guys at the gate, and they came back and got me. And and like I said, I never lost consciousness, but I was in some kind of severe pain. And I thought it was kind of strange because the guy said, okay, look, we've got life flight coming in. And I'm thinking, life flight? Why would I need a life flight? I'm probably an hour away from the hotel. And But I was welcoming the way I was feeling right now. So they picked me up. The pain was unbearable. Put me in the helicopter, and it was a 23-minute flight to Grady Memorial. And still didn't really think much about it, until I got there. They brought me in the trauma intensive care unit, and the doctor told me, said, "Look, they got to do some things to help you here, but we can't really. Your blood pressure is really, really low, and we can't give you any pain medicine." And I'm like, all right, right? So then he gives me a shot in my leg, my right femur, and drills a hole through my leg and inserted a pin. And I'm thinking, my leg's not broken. What's he doing? And he put 2 10-pound weights on it to kind of ballast out my side, because I think, my pelvis was so crushed. That would help just keep everything down. And at that point, I didn't know, but help stop the bleeding. And then they tried to put me in some real tight compression pants, which they finally got in me, and I kept complaining about, look, this is killing me. You guys are killing me. And the guy's stopped me and said, look, Ned, this is going to save your life. We got to do this. And that's when I started, like, what are you talking about saving my life? Well, you know, I ended up going through 7-8 units of blood. They couldn't get the bleeding to stop. They had to take me up to surgery, to perform some procedure where they put something in my artery in my leg and shot foam up in my pelvis to get the bleeding to stop. And at that point, I was still in critical condition. Brought me back to the room and monitored me all night, and then finally went in the next day at 1 o'clock to do the surgery, to put the pins in and the rods and all of that. But after the surgery is when the trauma doctor came in, and Deb and I were both, we were really kind of calm, you know, not really worried about it. He said, look, he said, I want to tell you guys something. You guys don't know how lucky you are. I said, yeah, we were lucky we had you guys here. He goes, no. He goes, these types of injuries result in death 25 to 30% of the time. And you had lost, your fracture was so significant, you were losing blood to the point where we couldn't stop. And he said, you were starting to crash. We were losing you. So I'm like, oh, my God, you know, well, I feel better now. And, but the whole key is there's been times where I've been out there and been up in a tree and reached for my phone and don't have my phone and think, God, man, that's so stupid. If something happened, you need your phone. And luckily for me, I had my phone. If I didn't have my phone, Deb was on her way to Montgomery. She wasn't coming back that night. And, I would have died right there probably in a couple hours.
I'll let others ask questions. I just want to let you know we're glad.
Ned, this is Vahe. This is Vahe. I'm so sorry for what you've been through. I wonder if you can have you ever faced your own mortality like this before? And what were you going through when you realized what was at stake?
I didn't face it. You know, I just thought I was going to be fine. You know, I just said, okay, my pelvis is broken. You know, I'm a pretty tough guy. I can handle the pain. You know, it just didn't occur to me. That this was going on. It did to my friends, but, you know, not to me. And until it was all said and done, and by then, I was pretty much kind of out of the woods at that point. They had gotten all the bleeding stopped and gotten the pelvis put back together. So, it was a little scary, getting on that helicopter, because I was in so much pain, and I was, kind of getting really, really woozy, and, I'm like, man, this is a bad one here, but I still felt like I was in great hands, and really didn't understand the gravity of the situation until I was through it.
As you look back, which isn't really back yet, Ned, has this had some kind of impact you can speak to in terms of what you appreciate or how close you think it was and how you feel about it?
No, I'm glad I had my phone. I'll tell you that. Like I told Deb, I am so safety conscious minded on this farm. And if I was just, if I was just climbing up a tree, helter skelter, but no, I had my safety. I did everything right. It was just an accident. And what's the cause of the accident? I don't know. I haven't been able to get back out there and won't be able to get back out there probably for, a month or so before I can be able to, hopefully get out of this chair. But I don't know if the strap broke. I just don't know what gave way, why the sand would fall the way that it did. It's just something, I told Deb, but I just think that it was time that God thought that I should become a better listener. So I get to sit and talk to you for 3 straight months now without moving. I got no place to run, no place to hide, and we both laugh about that. But, no, not really. It's just, one of those freaky accidents, and I just work to get through it.
Thanks, Ned.
Hey, Ned, it's Todd Lebo at Sports Radio 810. I'm glad you're feeling better. So I'm just trying to picture this. You were standing up in the stand, and you were trying to reach up onto the tree to put the safety line on the hook you'd already had there. So you were way high.
I've got my safety belt on, and the hook on the back. I was just reaching up to hook my back hook to the tree. Yeah, and down she came.
Wow.
Normally I'll hook up to the tree, and then put the lifeline on, drop it down, and then hook up to the lifeline and then, you know, walk the lifeline down and then tie it all up.
Right. So how did they get back to you? I mean, you told Deb exactly where you were, like what stand you're in, and so
I told her she's not real familiar with any of the stands. So she called Ned, my son, who was at home, and he came rushing out, and I told her, look, it's really, really simple. Come down the line like you're going to the lake, go past the house, come down the line, and when you get to where you turn left on the dam, turn right into the woods, and you'll see my four-wheeler right there in the first field. So she saw the four-wheeler, guided the emergency crews down there, and, found me under the tree.
So did they have to carry you out of there, or were they able to drive a vehicle down there?
Oh, yeah. No, they got a vehicle down there, but they had to carry me from, they had to probably carry me 70 yards.
How long you figure you were laying
and then, and then, they got, you know, to an old dirt road, which wasn't real comfortable, into the field, to get in the ambulance.
But how long you figure you were laying on the ground there waiting for everyone to come?
Probably 20 minutes.